Hey everyone. So we're going to jump right in. Again, the question is, how does OpenDAO compare to other projects that are in the market right now? For example, like DMM or Polymath, and what really sets OpenDAO apart? Why should anyone give OpenDAO a second look?
I'll try to answer that one. So in order to answer this question effectively, what one should do is first understand the challenges of connecting real world assets to DeFi. Now, when you are dealing with DeFi, the entire key value proposition is being permissionless. Smart contracts are not reliant on human intervention. So everything happens in an immutable fashion. Once the cascade starts, you can't really stop it. If somebody doesn't pay, their collateral is seized. When you're dealing with real world assets, you have human intervention. So you have to rely on somebody actually take possession of that. There are legal issues involved. Simple question, which I don't think has been answered quite effectively till date, is what happens if somebody in the real world does not repay? How do you ensure that their collateral is actually enforced on? So the issue over here is actually a bit more deeper than what kind of collateral does DMM use. For example, DMM does use car loans, for example. Yep. Realty does real estate, Centrifuge does invoices, etc. There are quite a few other projects which claim to, there's actually another project, which I'm not going to name here, but they talk about custodying gold. That's a massive nonsense because Digix Gold did that like about 6 years ago. And that's a pretty low bar. I mean, saying that, okay, trust us, we have gold somewhere. I mean, come on, guys. But it is what it is. But the point is not about what kind of assets are being used as collateral. The point is what kind of mechanisms which you have to ensure that the whole entire system is as permissionless as possible. And how is trust minimized? Don't say just trust us, okay? In fact, you should not trust us. You should trust our actions and the code and the processes which we have put in place to ensure that things will work the way they are expected to work, regardless of what we do and regardless of whether or not we are around. So it's all about that. So what we have done at OpenDAO is completely focus on building the bridge between real world assets and DeFi in a manner which is as seamless and as permissionless as possible. So that's where we have the whole concept of a cash box, which acts as a bridge, which we incentivize so that any liquidations which happen on chain, they don't have to wait for execution off chain. Somebody else sort of jumps in, takes responsibility for that. And that, I believe, is the key value proposition that is our key input in terms of thought leadership in the whole space. So our intention really is to start with on-chain assets such as BTC, Ethereum, etc., build liquidity, build distribution out, and then move to liquid off-chain assets, which are stocks, etc. Liquid off-chain assets such as stocks can be executed via APIs, which means we can make them permissionless. There is no need for human intervention. And once we have enough distribution, et cetera, we move to illiquid smart ticket, such as receivables, trade finance, renewable energy certificates, cars, solar panels, et cetera. And then once we have enough distribution for that, and once that is spawned out, we'll move to more illiquid big ticket stuff, such as treasuries, corporate bonds, real estate, et cetera, et cetera. So the key differentiator is really the positioning which we have and the focus on the main problem, which is there. So look out for that, I suppose.
So just to kind of nutshell all of that for everyone, you're saying, and correct me if I'm wrong, you're saying that what makes OpenDAO unique isn't just the types of assets that we're using, but the way that we interface with those assets and create the
I mean, it would be a bit disingenuous for us to say that okay, we are going to do more quality assets such as real estate, whereas somebody else is doing gold or somebody else is doing used car loans. it doesn't really matter what asset is there. What matters is what kind of interfacing are you doing and what processes you have to achieve the enforcement on that. Because in the absence of that, you can say I have a Mona Lisa custodied somewhere, or I have a bunch of diamonds custodied somewhere. But what happens when somebody doesn't pay? Mm. You have to trust me. So the entire objective is to make the protocol as seamless and as permissionless as possible. What that means is eventually we will be able to support all of these other players. If the community accepts them, then they can use us as a source of capital. There's also one more key differentiator. For example, DMM is really a money market, whereas we are moving towards a MakerDAI style stablecoin. So the speed of capital formation will be much faster. The interest rates will be much lower for people who borrow. But those are really ancillary things. When they are important, and we will probably make another video discussing why we made a switch from the money market model, which was a bit similar to what DMM had, to a stablecoin model. Now, to be fair, it was always our intention to move from the money market to the stablecoin. It's all there in the white paper. We're just accelerating it. And maybe we can do another video in which we can talk about why we chose to make the switch and why we're accelerating it.
Yeah, I think
But in terms of answering your question, the key item is really how we interface with the real world.
And to not trust us, but trust the code.
Trust the code, trust the processes, yeah.
I think that's a good take-home message. And that, I feel pretty satisfied with your answer. I know you're really busy right now, so I'll let you get back to that. And everyone out there in YouTube land or wherever you're watching, remember to like, subscribe, and ding, tick that bell, because we are coming out with so much content. So stay tuned. Bye, world.
Thank you, guys. Bye.